Welcome to my review of Seven Kingdoms 2, The Frighten Wars, released back on the PC in July of 1999. This game is the sequel to the original Seven Kingdoms and makes a few changes that streamline the engine and add an actual campaign mode that includes an actual narrative, even if it's a rather simple one. Story-wise, the main campaign follows your return to power after your kingdom has largely been pushed back by other human kingdoms and the Frighten Hordes. So this is about all you get for the game story-wise, but this campaign mode does contain a few interesting features, such as the ability to make decisions on who to ally with and which territories to fight for. These decisions are a nice touch in my opinion and help to ensure that you'll never play through a campaign the same way twice. Gameplay-wise, the game largely sticks to the original, but a few changes were made that improved the game for the most part from a technical standpoint. But before I get into my complaints, I'll go over the various aspects of this game. To start with, this game has made several changes to villages that should be noted. To start with, you'll notice that all the villages are now a single nationality instead of mixed like the previous game. This does make capturing independent villages easier, but also makes the various villages in the game seem highly racist. I guess this reflects back upon the nature of the first game, where mixed villages would tend to have lower loyalty than an unmixed village, but still seems a bit disturbing in my opinion. Overall, this change helps to streamline the game though, since you'll no longer have to use multiple generals in order to capture a village, or rely heavily on bribing a targeted village in order to acquire it because of all the nationalities contained within its borders. Another change made to the village is that they can now support a maximum population of 100 instead of the meager limit of 60 that was in the previous game. While this is a nice change, it also comes with the downside that population growth is far lower in this game, so you'll be more dependent on capturing the various independent villages in order to boost your tax base, as well as providing you with the larger population pool you'll need to recruit from in order to create the soldiers you'll have to defend your various villages and protect your various buildings from harm. And the final change made to villages is the inclusion of walls. The walls offer the various villages two distinct advantages. The first is that a walled-in village can throw objects at attacking forces, allowing them to weaken them far more quickly than simply throwing a mass of untrained villagers at them like the previous game. And the other is that the rate of the population of a village will go down while being attacked is also lowered. The next aspect of the game that I'll cover is the changes made to the various buildings such as mines, factories, war factories, and science towers. To begin with, all these buildings have been streamlined in terms of employees and that you can control how many people join them with a sliding bar. On the downside, the game has removed all the special units associated with these buildings, such as researchers and manufacturers, so you're no longer able to increase your weapon output by merely assigning the same workers the task of assembling them, and are restricted to building even more war factories and so on to improve your abilities in these areas. On the upside, the science towers are vastly improved, and now include additional topics developed, such as espionage techniques, enhanced fighting techniques for your soldiers, and increased production for food, mining, weapons, and factory workers. The science towers also allow you to develop special units for the various nationalities, such as ninjas and axe throwers. On the whole, the system is vastly improved and provides even more reasons to develop the awesome powers of science! Though moving on to third changes to the game, I'll now bring out the improvements made to the inns. Because of the changes made to how factories and science towers work, you no longer are able to hire highly skilled factory workers or researchers from inns, but instead restricted to hiring spies and soldiers. On the whole, this makes the inns far more functional than the previous game. In fact, you'll come to rely on inns to provide you with the highly trained troops beyond the normal limits of development that can be achieved inside of a fort. You'll also rely on inns to find skilled leaders to conquer the independent villages you'll need in order to stay afloat in this game. And you can also hire highly skilled spies early on in order to set up certain strategies discussed in some of my previous videos. And the final building that I'll discuss are forts. Forts have been improved slightly with the inclusion of defense towers that allow you to throw objects at enemies as well as really recruit people directly from a village into your forts. On the whole, these changes make forts a bit more dangerous in order to conquer, but the AI seems reluctant to fully develop all the towers that it can on the lower settings, at least. And the final aspect of Human Kingdoms that I wish to cover before offering up my complaints about the game is the changes made to the Seats of Power. But you can still utilize Seats of Power in order to invoke greater beings to attack your enemies, make them change sides, or increase the population of your villages. They also come with passive abilities such as increased food production, lower resistance in independent villages, or increase the rate of population growth. The Seeds of Power also include a random blessing ability as well, which can generate new mineral deposits on the map, or increase the combat levels of your troops contained within a fort. Although the Seeds of Power still suffer from the same problems as in the previous game, in my opinion, where certain greater beings are far more useful than others. In fact, I'd argue the Egyptians still get the best greater being in the game because it helps you increase your population far more rapidly than other nationalities, which have to rely on the default rate of population growth and the capturing independent villages in order to keep up. While my opinion on the Seats of Power is still highly mixed, my opinions about the spies as a whole are far more negative. My biggest and probably only major complaint about this game is that spies feel highly overpowered. In the previous game, they could be game changers if utilized correctly, for sure, but in this game, you almost are required to utilize them in order to take down and capture enemy kingdoms with little to no fuss. In effect, the spies are so potent in this game that it makes the military almost feel superfluous, since they'll largely serve as a stick to keep your enemies at bay. I guess you can call the last point pulling at straws, though, since in the first game you'd largely use your military in the same way while you developed a stockpile of weapons to throw at your enemy. But the ability to take down an entire kingdom with a few spies and assassins is a bitter pill to swallow in comparison to the more graphical nature of the battles in the previous game. With my major complaint out of the way, I'll now move on to my biggest disappointment with the game, which is the loss of C-maps. So speaking of the loss of maps, the game is also taking away the ability to select a given map by entering in a map code. The loss of C-maps is probably related to the inclusion of Frightens as a playable race. Many of the races of Frighten lack any sort of technology and instead rely upon ground-based military rushes, much like the Zerg in StarCraft. In my opinion, this makes the Frightens sort of disappointing to play as, since they lack any of the nuances possessed by the various human kingdoms in the game. But on that note, I think I'm finally ready to move on to discussing the graphics and sound. In the areas of graphics, this game feels like a definite improvement, with improved textures and buildings that are now specific to each of the human and Frightened kingdoms. On the sound front, the game has toned down the various sound effects to a more bearable level and provides some rather calming music for a game that is built around war and chaos. Overall, this sequel makes a lot of improvements on its predecessor, but I still find it disappointing. The changes made while improving from a technical standpoint have somehow lost the charm of the original game for me somewhere along the way. But if I was being honest with myself, if you enjoyed the previous game, then you'll probably find this one to be even better for the most part.